a special welcome to Amy's family and to Jess and Serge's family. And we're going to have an amazing baptism for Leah and for Sienna. So it's a double baptism this morning, which is great. It's lovely to have you all here, especially visitors from Paris and France and Cameroon here this morning. And really special that Amy's here because Amy was baptized here and now she's brought her daughter to be baptized here. So that's really nice. It's part of our family. We're going to, we're all different groups here, so why don't we do something a little bit different this morning? Let's just introduce ourselves to somebody we don't know. So you probably know everybody over there, you probably know over there, you all know each other. Let's just introduce yourself to somebody you don't know and say, good morning, welcome to church. How about that? Off you go.
That was easy enough.
By singing the well-known hymn, Morning Has Broken Like the First Morning.
Thank you.
let us pray. Humbly in your sight we come together, Lord. Grant us now the blessing of your presence here. These, our hearts, are yours. We give them to you, Lord. Purify your love to make it like your own. These, our eyes, are yours. We give them to the Lord. May we always see your world as with your sight. These, our hands, are yours. We give them to you, Lord. Give them strength and skill to do our work for you. These, our feet, are yours. We give them to you, Lord. May we walk along the path of life. These, our tongues, are yours. We give them to you, Lord. May we speak with healing words of life and truth. These, our eyes, are yours. We give them to you, Lord. Open them to hear your words of guidance. Our whole selves are yours. We give them to you, Lord. Take us now and keep us yours forevermore. Amen. Before we have a reading from Paul's letter to the Corinthians.
Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe.
To sing again, there is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son.
Jesus, God's own Son. Our gospel reading is taken from Luke chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Genesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone, and they were washing their nets. So he got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and took the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." But Simon answered, "Master, we've worked all night long, but have caught nothing. Yet, if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats, so they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. So also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him.
Imagine the story that we just heard from the gospel there. Here are a highly experienced group of fishermen out on a relatively predictable stretch of water. And they were living at a time when they took a lot more care over food supplies. They didn't overfish the Lake of Genesaret. They didn't fill it with plastic waste. So it would be presumably pretty unusual for there not to be any fish in the water, or for the fishermen not to know where to go and catch fish. But then along comes Jesus, not a fisherman, a carpenter, not someone who worked in the fields or spent long nights in boats pulling in heavy weights. And even worse than being a carpenter, he was a preacher. What sort of a job is that? Albeit he's a pretty popular preacher, with some magnetic film star qualities to be able to reach out to a crowd in the way that he does, so much so that the crowds press and press and press upon him. And then he sees the boats, so he borrows one from Simon Peter and sits in it and uses the boat as a kind of floating pulpit. Now, any good preacher, and I'm sorry I'm not one, has a gimmick up their sleeve, something to catch the attention of the hearers. And at that same time, the gimmick illustrates the teaching. So what happens next is not just a miracle, it's also a parable. Parable that is acted out in real life. Jesus' encounter with the fishermen disciples is Jesus acting out his message. And the first thing he says is, "Go out into deep water." And we know what it is to be in deep water. It means to be in difficulty. We might say, we're out of our depth. We might say, you jump in at the deep end, jumping into the wrong end of the swimming pool before you can actually swim. When I was a youth leader, quite a while ago now, I took a group of young people canoeing, and we went to the lake where we were going to do the canoeing, and we met up with the instructor, and We spent the morning with the young people learning how to canoe. And I, being the responsible person there, wanted to make sure that the young people were listening to what the instructor was said and they were behaving themselves, and they weren't very well behaved young people, I can tell you. I wanted to make sure they were listening to the safety requirements and so on and so on and so on. But by the afternoon, they had got pretty competent as a group of canoeists, and they were off doing their stuff. And the instructor came to me and said, "Would you like to go?" So I said, "Sure, okay," and I got in the boat, not really having listened to all the instructions that they'd been given. So I confidently sat in the canoe and paddled away until, for some mysterious reason, the canoe turned 180 degrees upside down. And there was me with my head in the water and the bottom of the boat up in the air, trying to remember desperately what the instructor had said you were to do when your boat tipped over. Fortunately, I have to say, survival instincts came into play and I was able to right the boat and survive with my life unharmed, but it's very, very wet. But being in the deep end is something that we all experience at some time in our lives. Maybe parents feel they're in the deep end suddenly, maybe quite often. Loving a child is also protecting a child in what might seem to be a very challenging environment, not at all easy. We might have taken on a project or a financial commitment which proves hard to complete or repay. And I don't think it's accidental that Jesus says to the disciples, "Go out into the deep water." In the Old Testament, the Bible says, "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you." Jesus is telling us that when we get into deep water, he is with us, whatever or whenever that might be. But he's also picked out Simon Peter and taken him into deep water. In a way, if we are serious about discipleship, then we should expect to find ourselves, like Peter, in unexpected and unsettling places. And then Jesus tells the fishermen to cast their nets into the deep water. And it's here you can understand why Peter becomes a little bit tetchy. Who are you to be telling us where the best fishing ground is? We know these waters. We know our jobs, thank you very much. We know what is good for us. We know how to do this thing, whether it's this thing called church, or this thing called parenting, or relationship building, or this thing called earning a living, or this thing called taking care of our responsibilities. We know what's best for us and what to do. And I bet Jesus smiled when Peter made those protests. J-D-I. Just do it. Just do it, Jesus says. Take the net and throw it overboard and then see what happens. And what happened was this, that there was a wealth of fish in those nets. There was salmon, there was cod, there was haddock, there was cuttlefish, there was squid, there was shrimps. I'm making that bit up, but there were a lot of fish. Jesus is giving a vital lesson to his disciples and his hearers. Believe first, and then you will understand. Trust first, and then you will understand. And too often in this modern world, we wrestle intellectually with faith. Can it be true? Once we've got it clear in our brains, then we can put our toes in the water of faith. With Jesus, it is the opposite. Jesus says, plunge yourself into the deep water of faith, and it will become clear. As the years go by, we can live a journey of ever deeper understanding. And as the story goes on, the disciples find themselves in trouble again, but for a different reason. This time there were too many fish. They were overwhelmed with the gift of faith. But they couldn't manage on their own. They couldn't handle the bounty which Jesus had given them by themselves. So they called their partners to share the riches gleaned from following Jesus and the wealth which God's creation has given to us. And we too need partners to share the wealth of the gospel. We need the church. We need partners in faith. The life of faith is life lived in community. And then Peter's reaction sort of makes sense. Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. An understandable response, but a wrong response. The grace and the love which is offered to us through Jesus Christ is an abundant and an abiding love. It is rich and deep and informs everything that we do. And it includes forgiveness for our weakness and our unworthiness. And it is that abiding love which we offer Lea and Sienna this morning. In 1 Corinthians we heard Paul also recognize his unworthiness. He says what each of one of us can say every day without fear. By the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. It was not I, the grace of God that is with me. Our call to be disciples and followers of Jesus Christ, to be baptized Christians, comes in many forms. For Paul, it was a blinding light, a dramatic moment of enlightenment. For Peter and his friends, it was witnessing a miraculous event on a lake. Whenever and wherever we experience the call of faith, that moment is the start of an adventure. Our baptism is a gift of grace and love, not only to children, but to all of us. It is the ritual which binds us together as a community, as a family. There are times in our lives when we will feel close to faith, and times when we feel a bit separate or a bit distant. And as our children grow, they too will sometimes feel close, sometimes distant. Always remember, faith is not an intellectual endeavor. Believe, then experience. And too often our modern minds leads us to ask questions, to wrestle with the idea of belief, and to take it. And it takes us into all sorts of places. The gospel turns it around. Start by believing, and then let understanding grow from there. Then you can question, then you can rest. Jesus simply says, trust and believe. Throw the net into the water and see what happens. St. Augustine puts it less dramatically. He said, believe. Believe in order to understand. Sometimes the act of believing will require us to push the boat out into deep waters. It is precisely then Jesus, through his grace, will allow us to say, I am what I am, and I am what I am by God's good grace. And this is what we can teach our children. Jesus is never separate or distant from us. He is there to call upon whenever we need. There is a wealth of resources available to each of us, from the youngest to the oldest. Just cast your nets in the deep wisdom of faith, which is so rich and so vast that it requires an entire lifetime and more. God bless us all as we follow him. Amen. Let's sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound.
Amen.
also Serge and Jess and the godparents of Sienna. Join them in giving thanks for the gift of Lea and Sienna. We celebrate the birth, naming, and baptism of these children, to wit the solemn undertakings on their behalf by parents and godparents, and to ask God's blessing on them. Let us pray. All-powerful and protective God, you lovingly saved Noah and his family in the ark from the flood, and safely led the children of Israel through the Red Sea, so inspiring baptism by water. And Christ was baptized in the River Jordan, making possible the washing away of our sin. We pray to you that you will, with the same tenderness and grace, look upon Lea and Sienna this day. Pour down your Holy Spirit as we receive them into the family of your church, our very own ark of safety. May they be steadfast in faith, joyful through hope, and rooted in love. As they steer their path in life, may they always be guided by your gospel and continually trust in you until their pilgrim journeys are complete and they know for themselves the breadth, length, and depth of your love. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Brought your child to be welcomed into the household of God and into the circle of family and friends. What name have you chosen? Will you care for this child, feed her and befriend her, listen to her and play with her, keep her safe and daily share your heart with her? Will you help your child to be your example, by your example and your teaching, to be honest, to be responsible and to help others? Will you respect, encourage, and guide her? Will you put her true needs before your pleasure? Will you try to order your life so that your child will be surrounded by love and others? And will you teach your child the love of God and the compassion of Jesus Christ? And will you, godparents, be a continuing friend to the godchild placed under your spiritual parent and be ready to help in times of special need? And will you, my brothers and sisters, accept this child into the family of Christ Church, offering care and support as she grows in faith? God bless you all and help you keep those promises. Now, Jess and Serge, you have brought your child to be welcomed into the household of God and into your circle of family and friends. What name will you chose? Try to order your life so that your child will be surrounded by love and holiness. And will you teach your child the love of God and the compassion of Jesus Christ? And will you, godparents, be a continuing friend to the godchild placed under your spiritual parent and be ready to help in times of special need? And will you, my brothers and sisters, accept this child into the family of Christ Church, offering care and support as she grows in faith? God bless you all as you carry out these promises. short readings from Scripture. When the people of Israel were first given guidance as to how to bring up their families, they were told, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words I command you today shall be in your heart, and you shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk to them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up." And the Gospel according to St. Mark tells us, "Then they brought young children to him, that he might touch them. But the disciples rebuked those who brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was greatly displeased and said to them, 'Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it.' And he took them up in his arms, put his hands on them, and blessed them." We welcome Leah and Sienna as Jesus. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I lay on you the name of Jesus Christ, and I sign you to his promise. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you. Easy Bible to read to help you as you instruct or teach or engage your children in the story of the Gospel. Christ as a light illumine and guide you. Christ as a shield overshadow you. Christ under you, Christ over you, Christ beside you, Christ ahead of you, Christ within you, Christ in the heart of friend and stranger. Christ is your light every day of your lives. My brothers and sisters, I present to you your new sister in a special song for Lair and Sienna.
And for all of us.
For all of us, really.
Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the teardrops fall? Why should I feel so lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. He is I, is on these little sparrows, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on these little sparrows, and
God, our deepest thoughts and concerns. We pray for the families of Lair and Sienna. They together, they are empowered and enabled to bring up these wonderful little children in the knowledge that they are loved, cared for and protected. We pray for all parents, especially those who struggle with difficult times. We pray for teachers and those with the responsibility of caring for children. We pray for children throughout the world, those who are denied their rights, those who are denied education, and those in great need. And we pray at this time for our country, going through confusing and difficult times. We pray those empowered with the responsibility for decision making are also empowered with wisdom and insight and understanding, and make decisions for the good of the whole people and not just a few. And we pray, Lord, for the Church of Jesus Christ, that we might be an ark of safety, a refuge point where people can come and be themselves and learn and know of the grace of Jesus Christ, and be able to say with confidence, I am what I am. I am who I am. Lord, we pray to you this day. We pray to you with conviction. We pray to you with understanding, that you might take us on the next journey of our faith, whatever our starting point is, and lead us to a deeper understanding of the wisdom contained in your gospel and an enriching experience of the love and the grace that you have for us in our daily lives. In your name we pray, the words which you taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Thank you all very much for joining us here in worship this morning. It's been lovely to have you. And please come again. You're always very, very welcome. One important announcement: on Tuesday evening we have a church meeting. It won't be here, it'll be at the home of Liz and Philip and Kate. If you don't know where that is, ask them, and they'll tell you. And then fewer activities this month, but at the end of the month we have an evening of short films. One of those films, Black Sheep, has been nominated for an Oscar, so that, and the details are all on the website. If you wish to make a contribution to the church, there will be an offertory during this this closing hymn. It isn't a compulsory offertory. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, great hymn. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. God, who is with us when you sit and when you stand, encompass you with love. and lead you by the hand. May God, who knows your path and the places where you rest, be with you in your waiting, be your good news for sharing, and lead you in the way that is everlasting. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with each and every one of us, now and forevermore. Amen.